Thank you, Larry, and thank you for the good critique that made me professor of neurology 25 years ago. So I also have a story with Larry. So this is my topic, and for those not working with MS, MS is a serious disease. The natural cause, you have a lot of relapses ending up in progression. Hopefully with the new treatments, we perhaps can postpone this. So, and then there is a triggering phase, which I will talk a lot on, where there are both environmental factors and genes. So, in fact, MS is often presented as some form of mystery, but it's not. I think traditional hypothesis-driven research has learned us a lot about the inflammation that may finally lead to destructions of myelin and neurons. And the pharmaceutical industry has been quite effective in finding ways to block various steps here leading to this damage. However, all of these treatments are kind of broad. They hit these kind of mechanisms in a broad way, and that can lead to infections. We don't know about cancer. Certain diseases may worsen disease, as we heard from Lars just. And some other treatments that have been used can elicit other autoimmune disease or even worsen MS. So I think we, despite all the progress in the treatments, we need to learn more about the disease to be much more precise in the treatment. And the way we have approached this is to study risk genes, lifestyle, environmental factors, and their interactions. And to find the cause of the disease, why not ask the patient? That is the kind of way we have thought about this. So first, a little bit about the genetics. We know there is heritability, especially among monozygotic twins. And perhaps this heritability has been overestimated before. One comes up in lambda scores of around 7. But, I mean, for sure, we know heredity or genes are involved. And there are two categories of genes. It's the HLA complex and non-HLA genes. And I've talked superficially about both. And with regard to the non-HLA genes, already during the preceding lecture, we heard about their low odds ratios. They are in the kind of magnitude of up to 1.3, most of them much lower. And therefore, we can never use this information for genetic counseling or predicting disease. But as we have heard, they can be the starting point to find pathogenetic pathways that we know are important for the disease. So that's a point to find genes. So genetics is not research, it's mapping and perhaps the start for research. And as it is now, the latest GIVAs through the International MS Genetics Consortium have now revealed up to 200 independent associated variants. And these are Manhattan plots showing the probability that a certain locus should be important. And here we have the strongest locus, the HLA. So to summarize this, we have now these 200 loci. And I have been surprised how little overlap it has been with other inflammatory diseases, perhaps apart from primary biliary cirrhosis. And as we discussed already in the last lecture, we are now in the post-genetic area. We have to go into functional studies, and this is, of course, needed if to use this further on, translated into therapy. One thing I think is important, and that is all the loci, or nearly all, found so far, are related to immunity. There has been a debate in MS whether MS would primarily be a neurodegenerative disease, and the inflammation you find in the brain would be secondary to destruction of neurons for other reasons. But I think this on top of therapies, you know, interfering in immune function, is an extremely strong argument that MS is primarily an inflammatory disease. Another point is that so far we have mapped genes that have to do with incidence, not really to severity. And I think this is one of the next steps one should do in MS genetics. Now, I will just pick out one example on top of the ones that Lars was telling about on a gene where we have done some contribution. And that is on the interleukin 22 receptor binding protein. And some years ago, we did a lot of rat genetics. That was before the era of GWAS. We could only do genetics with very big populations of rats, and found one region, the interleukin 22 receptor binding protein gene. And at that time could associate it to MS also, and in the recent GWAS, this particular gene is associated. This molecule is interesting. It's a decoy receptor for interleukin 22, and it has a signaling receptor, and is mainly regarded as a pro-inflammatory cytokine. It turns out that the risk genotype is correlated to a higher expression of this interleukin 2 binding protein. And doing an inducible rat knockout of the protein, it turns out that knocking out this decoy receptor is in fact ameliorating disease. And playing around with this in different double knockouts, deleting IL-22 or the receptor and so on, it turns out that the function of IL-2 in the central nervous system is rather protective, and a too strong decoy binding of this is kind of worsening disease. So through this, we conclude that IL-22 may be protective in neuroinflammation, and neutralization of IL-22 through high levels of this binding protein confers detrimental effects. And of course, companies play around with blocking or giving different cytokines, but this is then basic data that should contribute to be considered in this relation. We come to the HLA, and it's very difficult to explain HLA. And when I ask the persons during their neurology course what HLA is, they have forgotten what they learned 5 years previously. No one knows what it is. And it's among the most important molecules we have. And it's a particular allele, DR15-01, that predisposes for MS with a risk increase of around 3. And probably the kind of disposition or predisposition of this would relate to peptide binding specificities. And there is a second class 1 gene that is the restriction element for CD8 cells that confers protection. And here's quite unknown how this would work out. But these two genes are important to consider in relation to environmental factors, which will be the main message of my talk here. So finding all these 200 genes and the HLA interaction, HLA influence and so on, we only explain a part of the heritability. And there are many reasons for that, but one possible reason is that there could be an interaction between genes and environmental factors. And there are a number of arguments suggesting that lifestyle and environmental factors are important for MS, like migration studies, geographical gradients, and the strong disconcordance rates among twins. And there is also a phenomenon that the incidence of MS in most countries have more or less doubled during the last 50 years, but it's kind of stable among men. And genes do not change, so there must be something in the environment that changes. So, and when we started this like 10, 15 years ago, geneticists and epidemiologists work quite separately, and few with data in both. And we try to bypass this by starting collecting DNA, plasma, and also data, questionnaire data on lifestyle and environmental factors, and have now ended up in a complete material of 12,000 persons with MS and 10,000 controls where we have these types of data. You need power in these types of studies. And this, to study interactions, I mean, we selected now the strongest genetic impacts on MS, and that is carriage of the DR15.1 allele or non-carriage of the protective class 1 allele. And interaction you can assess by, if you have two different factors and add them on top of the one, if you get something on top of the pure addition of the two factors. So here's an interaction effect. And that suggests an action within the kind of same pathogenic pathways, if you can find that. This is a busy slide, but with this, there are numerous factors that have modest effects on the risk to get MS. We have smoking, passive smoking, organic solvents, infectious mononucleosis, low sun exposure, obesity, night work, oral tobacco, snus, nicotine, which is health preparation. I'll talk more about that, and so on. And I will take a couple of examples. But from these studies, what we have concluded, also with regard to several of them interacting with the HLA, is that they should act on the immune system somehow. So it's a very similar situation as we have with genetics, where the, all kind of influences seems to act on the immune system. Finally, perhaps leading to this scenario. So the overall conclusion is that there are many lifestyle environmental factors. MS is a complex disease, and they have modest odds ratios in the range of 1.5 up to 2. Many of them act during adolescence, before the age of 20. Many of them interact with MS risk genes, and through that one could kind of suggest that they should all act on the immune system. This is just a very recent study we published in Annals of Neurology. Kind of non-specific events can lead to or can increase the risk for MS. I did nerve trauma experiments 25 years ago and could show that autoreactive T cells may expand if you traumatize nerves or the brain, activating autoreactive T cells that may lead to neuroinflammation if you are genetically susceptible. And here, quite striking increases of the risk for MS appears if you have one or two brain concussions. Now I come to obesity, which would be kind of appropriate for this meeting, I think. There was a paper published 2009 that body size and risk of MS was increased. We could replicate that in both men and women. And there have been a couple of papers later in pediatric MS. And there are reports of other organ-specific inflammatory diseases connected to obesity. So here is combined data from the Swedish material and an American material from Lisa Barcelos. And there is more or less a linear increase in the odds ratio or the risk to get MS depending on the BMI, starting out at quite modest BMIs, around 25. We could also show that here you have the HLA-mediated risk increasing and being highest if you are DR15 positive and A2 negative. But look what's happened if you have a BMI above 27 at age 20. Then you can get a 15-fold increased risk, quite drastic. And that was replicated in the American material. So a high BMI during adolescence have reproducibly been associated with the risk of MS. There is an interaction with MS immune response genes in form of HLA, suggesting that this should act through the immune system. The mechanism, of course, is unclear, but as we have heard, obesity induces a state of low-grade inflammation that may increase the risk for activation of CNS-specific immunity. There are other options as well. Vitamin D, for example, is lower in persons that are obese, but less likely because we have our data are unaffected by correction for sun exposure habits. Now we come to the second factor that I will discuss a little bit more in detail, and that is smoking. And there are numerous studies, and a meta-analysis of them results in an odds ratio of around 2. And also passive smoking, we have analyzed that. And passive smoking, in fact, can reach quite similar levels of risk increased as active smoking. And smoking after the diagnosis of MS also kind of reduces the time until you get secondary progression and worse disease. So the key findings here increases the risk, and there is also a dose-dependent effect, and it pays off to stop smoking, but it takes like 5 years before the risk disappears. And now to my favorite topic, and that is oral tobacco, snus, and that is dose-dependently decreasing the risk for MS. And we don't know why, but there are nicotinergic receptors on very many inflammatory cells. But the point I have here is that it's not the nicotine, it's something that should happen in the lung. The lung as an immunoreactive organ. And here again, we have this dramatic interaction. Here you have the increasing risk with different HLA types. But if you add smoking on top of that, you can have a 20-fold increased risk for MS, 2,000%. We have recently done studies on organic solvents. There are a meta-analysis of this with an odds ratio of 1.5. We have been able to confirm that. And it turns out that organic solvents, in the same way as smoking, interact with HLA to increase risk. And if you both smoke and are exposed to organic solvents, you can come up to figures like a 30-fold increased risk to get disease. And this is also an argument that the lung may be involved. So the way we think about this is that smoking induces lung irritation. There are many papers showing that you get a chronic inflammation in the lung. Perhaps the smoking can induce post-translational modification of peptides that would make them much more immunogenic. And this may then trigger cells that finally go to the brain and cause MS. We know much less about the CD8 contribution. An interesting thing is that smoking is not only increasing the risk for MS, but it's increasing the risk for rheumatoid arthritis on another HLA allele and also myositis. And the only thing that can discriminate in between peptides is the HLA, suggesting once again that it has to do with peptide binding somehow. And this was a nice paper some years ago from Alexander Flügel in Göttingen, where he could show that autoreactive T cells on their way to the brain got an inflammatory phenotype in the lung. So there, autoreactive T cells are present in the lung and can there be triggered to cause neuroinflammation. So the overall conclusion of this I have is that lifestyle and mental factors interact with MS risk genes and support their causal role in MS, and they should act on the immune system. We need to study MS more to have more specific therapies. Personally, I have a bias towards adaptive immunity. It may be difficult, but one should try. And genetics and epidemiology together may lead us to testable hypotheses. Genetics should take environmental exposures into account, I think, in the future. But the opposite is also true, that epidemiological investigations should take care of the genetics. And a little bit as reference to the previous talk, one can have fantastic options with big data to compare genetics with national patient registries, with pharmacy databases, and so on. So there is a nice time ahead. And here are my collaborators, Ingrid Kockum for the genetics mainly, Lars Alfredsson for the epidemiology. And we have a nice collaboration now with Lars Fugger as well, not yet resulting in any papers, but I expect nice things to come. Thank you.
Your data and your comment about the chewing tobacco, a trial of varenicline Chantix, the smoking cessation drug, ought to be good in MS. It's an alpha 7 agonist.
Okay, sounds attractive. It would be nice to make a short phase 2 on some way.
We'll talk.
Yeah.
Any comments, questions?
There's one there.
The vitamin D data is a little bit disturbing. I mean, what does it mean that vitamin D can be related to increase?
Okay, I left that out, and I could talk for 2 hours on it. And the problem with vitamin D is that you cannot really discriminate in between sun exposure and vitamin D levels. And my intuitive belief, after having read a lot around this, is that probably the sun exposure is more important than the vitamin D levels. We have data where we, the effect of sun exposure is there and not affected by the vitamin D levels, but not vice versa. Suggesting, and there is an Australian study on this as well. And this is a little bit important from a health perspective. I mean, perhaps we are too protective with regard to exposing ourselves to the sun, especially during in adolescence. And I don't think all trials with vitamin D will work in MS. There are many trials going, and I think they are all negative, more or less. Or do you, Larry, have any more information?
There was from Celgene data at ECTRIMS. I was involved in it, but in a placebo group in a very big trial, they stratified if your level was in the lower quartile and along the way. But in short, your risk of getting a new lesion was reduced threefold if you were in the upper quartile. So whether it comes from the sun or comes from a pill, we'll hear more about vitamin D later in this session, but it's a very important factor.
It's important, but very difficult to tell apart the sun exposure and vitamin D effect.
People who don't live in Sweden just assume the sun is there all the time, like California. So. All right. Thank you, Thomas.